campus ministry. I want to look into our future in campus ministry, and I want you guys to see your part in the future that we play. And all of that, if you see your part in the future, driving then this mission, keeping your faith in the summer, so that when you come back, you are actively engaged in creating your future that God has in mind for campus ministry at Holy University. So that's the course we're taking. It sounds roundabout, but I think it's going to get us to that point, what is going to engage you to recognize that you are a part of it. So we're going to celebrate campus ministry. We're going to celebrate its past. We're going to look into the future. We're going to talk about your participation in the future of it, and how your faith is critical for the success of that future. But the past that we have to look at can't be just the last, 8 months. The past that we celebrate is the past in which God has not only worked in the last 8 months here at Golden Green State University, but how God has worked in the past 50-year plus in the work of campus ministry at Golden Green State University. So let me give you a little history about how Veritas, I'll say Thomas More, all came to be where it is today, and how God has worked in it. Golden Green State University celebrates its 100th anniversary this year. You all know that. It's all over the campus. As a small university at the beginning, as you know, there was a Catholic presence here. That Catholic presence was served by St. Aloysius Parish. And St. Aloysius Parish actually had Catholic university students who go to the Mass. And those Catholic students formed themselves into a group. I'm not sure they recognized it officially as an EGSU student group, as Veritas, or groups are as they are today. But there was a Catholic presence, and those students gathered themselves together. As the university began to go broke, particularly post-World War II, just the population of the university boomed. And because there's a large Catholic population in Northwest Ohio, so did the Catholic student population. In those years, the bishop made a decision to create for the university community a separate parish to serve the needs of BGSU students, faculty and administrators. And in that, what we created, as we know today, is St. Thomas More University Parish, which many of you are part of. St. Thomas More University Parish is kind of unique in the sense that it's not a territory parish. Many of you come from back home, you're a part of the parish. And the participation in that parish comes from the geographic boundaries. Okay, so like Tiffin, Ohio, Tiffin St. Mary's Parish is our parish. The membership of that parish is made up by a geographic boundary as defined by the bishop. St. Aloysius Parish is a territorial geographic parish. The bishop, many, many years ago, defined this territory that surrounds St. Aloysius as its territory. And when that happens, through the kind of the hierarchy, the Catholic Church is structured, the bishop has shepherding care of all Catholics, or all souls, really, Northwest Ohio. The bishop can't be that shepherd for all. Therefore, he delegates that to some degree to a local shepherd, which is a pastor. So, St. Aloysius Parish is established by our bishop to serve the Catholic and the souls in this geographic area. About 50 years ago, the Holy Spirit moved the bishop to say, wait a minute. What about the souls that are on campus of Golden Green State University? How well is a church shepherd? He established what they call a particular parish, St. Thomas More, to serve those needs. A particular parish is different than a territorial parish. A particular parish is, meaning it's not the participation of that parish is defined by boundaries, geographic boundaries. A particular parish is defined by a particular membership. Some of you might know from larger towns, cities of Cleveland or Columbus, Toledo, and in those cities, there are sometimes what they call particular parishes. There are things like the Irish parish or the Italian parish. The Catholic parishes, then they're actually established by the bishop to serve not a territory, but to serve a particular people, the Irish descendants or the immigrants of Italy. So here, what's been established is a particular parish to serve BGSU, and that's St. Thomas. that was established about 50 years ago. And at that time then, through the first founding pastor, Father Oliver, he began to build what we know today as St. Thomas More Newman Center, or Parish Center. 3 years ago, we celebrated the 50th anniversary of building our church. That place that we have there on Thurston, right across from McDonald's, that was purchased by the diocese to serve as the Newman Center of the parish. First, there were houses on Thurston, right where Newman Housing is. Behind the houses, there was a garage, a cinder block building. We know that cinder block building today as a fireside. Okay, so fireside existed, and it was a garage. Oliver, the founding pastor, converted the garage into like office space on the first floor, and then up on the second floor, the upper rooms, that was converted into dorm space for students. They had moved from a house on Wooster Street to this particular location in Thurston about 50 years ago. Some of you might have heard this story, but it's a really important part of understanding campus ministry and how God has blessed it. When the church was built over 50 years ago, Father Oliver, the pastor, really was dependent upon the help of students to build the building. We don't have a lot of money. And so when it came to building the church, he didn't have the resources to contract an architect. He didn't have the resources to contract builders. He himself was the architect, and he himself was the student of the builders. This legacy is evident in our church. When you walk in and you look up to the ceiling, which is wood, looks kind of like there's smudges on it. It's kind of dirty, but if you really look closely at it, what you see are not smudges, but you literally see fingerprints in the wood on the ceiling of the church. This is a testimony to what God did through the young people 50 years ago. These fingerprints are the fingerprints of university students who, one Saturday morning, Father Oliver put out a call to all students who were available to come over to St. Thomas and unload the flatbed trucks that had all the wood necessary for the ceiling. A slew of students, apparently a good portion of the football team came over. They unloaded these flatbed trucks. It was an August day, from what I understand, or late September, heavy duty night preceded it, and so the wood was rather wet when they took it off the flatbed trucks. The work was hard and laborious. The people who participated sweated. Apparently, the sweat of their fingers and the oil of their fingers meshed with the moisture of the wood left this indelible print on their fingerprints on the wood of the ceiling. I've never seen it before, but it's a great testimony to our history that why St. Thomas More is what it is today is because of the students who stepped up to literally build the place. Campus ministry from St. Thomas then would go off in many different directions. A few things are a hallmark to the campus ministry to follow from there. One thing would be to be operating as a parish. So it would be serving sacramental needs of BGSU, students, faculty, administrators. It would operate as a parish, offering Sunday masses, sacraments, baptism, marriage, confirmation, all of the preparation necessary for that. When necessary, bury the dead. It would be a sacramental presence for those who are ill, suffering from illness. Provide the Eucharist every Sunday as well as the weekday. So it's a church, a parish. But what makes this particular is the fact that the bishop asked us to be a presence to the university life. This happened in two ways. One would be students formed themselves into Veritas, which back then had been known as the Catholic Newman Club. Catholic Newman Club was established because Newman Club was kind of the going genre, you might say, of how campus ministry was unfolding in cyclic campus across the United States. We call ourselves the Newman Center. That term. Newman Center is referring to actual Blessed Cardinal Henry Newman, who was a cardinal bishop up in England. And in the 1800s, he found what was part of the Oxford movement, a renewal of the intellectual life of Catholicism in England. For whatever reason, his identity as one who was involved with the intellectual formation of college students kind of took off in America. He himself worked University life in England. And so what's across America now are Catholic Newman Clubs, or Newman Centers. Centers that are actually serving university students and So, future reference, you got a sibling who goes off to a second university, and you ask them, do they have a Newman Club there, a Newman Center? That's a typical kind of Catholic language for the work of the church in secular universities. Newman Centers, Newman Clubs, that kind of stuff. So back about 50 years ago, Newman Club, Catholic Newman Club, became a presence to university students by university students. At the same time, we operate as a parish, we operate as a Catholic Newman Club, we also operate in housing. Father Oliver always provided alternative student housing for students. First, again, it's about fireside. I don't know how they ever did it up there, if they ever rented out a room. What do you think? Newman House is bad now. But in 1964, he again, along with students, built our current Catholic Newman housing. He built it onto that. The Newman fireside was renovated, the church was built, the gymnasium, the classrooms, the parish offices, and then in 1964, Newman housing was added onto the front. Also around 1967, they did additional building, and that building, those buildings are no longer owned by the parish. But if you're looking at the parish, straight ahead, you look off to the right, it's the Newman Housing, parish office, all of that. To the left, you see a fence, and beyond that fence, beyond some pine trees, are actually four units of like duplexes, kind of townhouses, first and second story apartments. Those were also built by Father Oliver and students to accommodate married couples and families. Those were sold off in the 70s. So housing was a part of the mission. I think what it was, Father Oliver recognized that, you know, how students live, what the environment they live in has a direct impact on their formation. University life actually knows that your living experience, your housing experience, is one of the key factors of retention. You know, if you're having a good experience with your roommate, like a dorm life, they know that probably a freshman will move into a sophomore year. Here go, they're going to do dorms. It's to help with retention. But I think Father Oliver's vision for housing was bigger than that. It's not retention. But it was recognizing that when students live together, they can actually form something that's very formative and instructive. So Newman Housing exists as an alternative faith-based retention living community for that purpose. That's our past. And that leads us to today. And as you look back at your year, I hope you can see how God has worked through Candace's ministry to touch your life and bring you to the place where you are today. As you look back at the past 8 months, anyone share with us how God has used Candace's ministry to touch your life and your school year?
My name is Casey Parker. I teach a 7th grade CCF at St. Tom's. And this is my first year. I'm a freshman. So basically, I started coming to Mass on Sundays. And on the first day, they kind of have little sheets, what you'd be interested in doing. So I saw the little thing for the teaching. I'm like, I love kids and stuff like that. A lot of siblings, so I'll do that. And then something I just like called right away just to get involved. But throughout much of the first semester, and even until about 2 or 3 weeks ago, all I could do was going to the 9 o'clock Mass at night and then teaching on Sundays. So, but I'm starting to realize now that, a couple weeks ago, I was in the union by myself, and Amy and some of the other guys on Tuesday that were on the most together group, she recognized me and she called me over. She saw me at St. Thomas. She thought I was going to CCF or something there. I had a little sister in there. I was actually teaching. And then, but for whatever reason, Amy recognized me, she called me over. And they're all like, all right, tomorrow's Veritas, you should come to that. And I was worried about Veritas.